We're living in a society which places great responsibility on those who work to deliver justice. Having said so, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and fellow media practitioners. Welcome to the studios of the National Television Network. Thanks for accepting the invitation to attend this press conference with the Director of Public Prosecutions, Mr. Daarsrean Greene. Mr. Greene accepted to serve as the country's DPP some 3 months ago, and so he wanted to update you on some of the matters before his office. Welcome, Mr. Greene.
Thank you very much.
At this time, Mr. Greene will begin with some remarks, following which the floor will be open to you for questions and comments. I hand you over to Mr. Greene.
Much obliged. A pleasant good morning to all who are present, and I see some who are late now, as we ought to have started at 8:30. And to the citizens of this nation by extension, I've convened this short meeting with the media in an effort to update the public on a few issues that have clearly been of immense concern to this nation over the past few years. However, before I embark on sharing with you what I can disclose about these matters, I wish to inform you that although matters are of great concern or public concern, it is of paramount importance that I remind some of us who know and also educate and inform others who may not of the need to treat matters that are being investigated by the police and those that are before the courts of this country with the level of confidentiality that is necessary as these matters are sub judice. This simply means that these matters are under judicial consideration. The sub judice rule may be breached by public statements that risk prejudging matters or issues that are before the courts, in particular, commenting on the strengths and weaknesses of cases before the court and discussing and prejudging the case against a defendant. By extension, issues relating directly to any matter, especially evidence obtained or the versions of events given by the parties, ought to be strictly forbidden. And that is for the members of the media houses. In other words, we ought not to try to decide matters that are before the courts in the court of public opinion. I can say without hesitation that this public discussion of matters, as I've said before, can significantly prejudice the Crown's case and equally that of the defendants. I've observed of late that this discussion has become quite popular, but I must inform that this practice needs to stop immediately, as it is an offense under the Criminal Code. I refer you particularly to Section 380, subsections G and H of our code. Reads as follows. A person commits the offense of contempt of court if he or she, part G, publishes any matter which is intended or is likely to prejudice the fair trial or conduct of criminal proceedings. H, publishes any matter which prejudges issues which are to be tried or are being tried before the court. And this is punishable indictably with imprisonment. I wish to say no more in this matter. Reference to only thing I can indicate is please be guided accordingly. I've noticed a trend, persons indicating certain things about matters which have not been completed before the court. Remember that there's an investigative stage, then the matter, if it meets the threshold, goes to court, and then is determined whether by a judge, a magistrate, or a judge and jury. So we have to be cognizant of that. In light of what I have expressed, I shall issue statements to you touching and concerning the following matters, having due regard to the fact that all are sub judice, as I said before. So I think that we all are with me in that regard. It is clear that the matters of great discussion would have been the police shootings, which has been phrased as the impacts report, the CARICOM Implementation Agency for Crime and Security, right? Matters concerning Iftikhar Shams, who was charged with 49 counts of obtaining property by deception. We referred to this as the Lambert's matter. Investigations into the death of the British national, Oliver Benjamin Gobat. So I will touch on these issues. Then I shall entertain a few questions arising from my submission to you. I will commence with impacts, if I'm so allowed. With reference to the alleged police shootings, I have in excess of 21 of these matters under my review. As promised, I have made an extensive review, I can say, unequivocally, of the majority of these cases, and I was able to plot a way forward with the majority of these matters. In some instances, I have written to the Commissioner of Police expressing my opinion. I must state that many of these matters are still incomplete in terms of the criminal investigations, and as such, I cannot disclose details of any findings of what in particular is missing from these investigations, etc., as this would only prejudice the due process, right, that is expected in these matters. And I hope that everyone can appreciate that. We don't try to prejudge issues. We have to allow matters to complete the investigative stage, right? So we know that some matters have been sent to the coroner's court in these, some of these shootings, and certain pronouncements have been made. But these pronouncements, I must say to you, are no findings of guilt, okay, on the part of any persons involved, right? The result of an inquisition is quite distinct. So I can assure everyone that these matters are not shelved. I basically work on these matters every single day. There's a lot to be done. We have even experienced matters that have arisen since my tenure and my commencement in office. And I can say one thing, that it is not mandatory that an inquisition be ordered in these matters where there is any police-related shooting and the subsequent expiration of a subject. I can commence a criminal or criminal proceedings subsequent to a police investigation. So I want to clarify that there is not an absolute rule that these matters ought to go to inquest, right? So we will have these matters resolved, but I would ask for the patience of the public, and I'm not going to be indicating every single stage. These are very sensitive issues. The liberty of certain subjects are at stake, right? And we must also consider, you know, what has happened in these tragic circumstances. So we need, and I am imploring the public to allow me, you know, some patience. Your patience is solicited in these matters. Right? In terms of the Lambert's Academy and Mr. Shams, I think we may have heard that this matter, one of the matters, has been settled. All right? This was a matter concerning 49 counts of obtaining property by deception, where Mr. Shams was charged with all of these counts. We are aware that there were a number of students here who remained in this country for just about 2 years. And we are aware that the state had to assist them greatly in subsisting and sustaining themselves during the course of their stay, which has been very, 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 you know, difficult for the government and people of St. Lucia, as all of these persons have been charges on us. I believe I'm reliably informed that over $1.3 million was spent to maintain these persons. I made a decision based on what I recognized in this matter to allow and to the mediation process in criminal proceedings to take effect and take place in these proceedings. This is a very lawful way of dealing with matters, bearing in mind the defendant at the time spent over 2 years, just about 2 years, on remand. Something that should be inconceivable, you know, in the 21st century. I have looked at the matter, and we proceeded to mediation. As a result of that, there were, if I can tell you, the charges were obtaining property by deception, contrary to Section 211 of the Criminal Code, 49 charges, 49 virtual complainants, and which comprised of victims and also they comprised of students of the Lamberts Academy, which would have been the students and the dependents, sorry. So the matter was resolved. I believe it was resolved justly and to great benefit to all parties concerned. So I can say safely that one aspect of Mr. Sham's charges have been dealt with. So we can move on to the remainder of them. However, again, as I indicated, the principle of sub judice, you know, we won't speak to any of these other issues. Right? Clarified that one. The final matter would have been for the clarification of the what has been going around in terms of my authority being fettered or usurped in some way, shape, or form by certain missives being sent to the Home Office of the United Kingdom pertaining to the death of Oliver Benjamin Gobart. I can say categorically that that is not true, that I can say that I did send correspondence to the Home Office reference to this matter. And as is expected, all the parties concerned, because anytime there's a death of foreign nationals, etc., as expected, persons will inquire the foreign countries, the consulates, etc. And I did update the office of the Prime Minister as to what the position was in this matter. And again, as I can say, as I indicated from my introduction, this matter, being of a sensitive nature of this, you know, in this manner, I will not discuss issues pertaining to this matter at all. This will simply compromise the investigations, etc., and I am not about to delve into this. But I can safely say that as a small state, we have required great assistance from our friends overseas, the more developed states, in dealing with investigations. And I don't see any sign of this stopping. As everyone can see, we are just not capable of doing all of the investigations and the stages of the investigations, the fine-tuning of the investigations on our own. There would always be a need for foreign assistance. Right? Touch that. I don't know what the media would want to ask about any other matters. I'm willing, once I can, to assist them in that regard. Right? So that would be the extent of my initial contribution to this conference.
Thank you, sir. We now open the floor for questions or comments. We want to do this as orderly as possible. So I would ask that you raise your hand and indicate, well, your name and the media house that you represent.
Janelle Norville, Choice TV. My question is about a tourist who was killed in Beaufort on his yacht craft. What is going on in that case?
Oh, yes. Oh, that is the Pratt matter. Definitely, we are at trial before this matter. With this matter, is going through at the High Court presently. Again, I can't grant you any insight into the proceedings, as again, this would greatly prejudice our proceedings. But I can assure you, this matter is ripe for trial.
Okay.
Without going into much detail, like you said, you're not able to. What exactly is the process in regards to the impact report? I know you said you're doing the reviews, but from there, because from what we understood, the evidence is in Jamaica and whatnot. So how would you be addressing that?
All speculation, my friend. All speculation. And we must stop this. I cannot alert you to anything that I have endeavored to do in this matter. That's crazy. Right? I will not speak to where evidence is or where it's not, but I can say safely that I have reviewed everything reference to this matter. And there is definitely a way forward, which we are going to pursue. Definitely. Right? So we need to wait patiently. I know that persons have been waiting, but I want to just comment on that. The impact report is not an investigation for the purpose of criminal investigation. As I said earlier, these matters still have to be, to some extent, completed in terms of the investigation for criminal proceedings, if any. So we must understand the distinction, not the impact report and what it said and all of this, right? This is exactly in the face of what we ought not to do, to even try to divulge anything of that nature. Let us be fair to all parties concerned, right? Yes?
Clinton Reynolds, just following up on this initial question, there has been a lot of talk about evidence and where evidence is.
Right.
So I don't think it's that crazy to be asking about evidence. Also, in terms of in terms of the pronouncements made by the former Prime Minister, in what way might those pronouncements prejudice the case in terms of impacts and what you can move forward with?
Right. Number one, I will reiterate to you, my friend, that the issue of evidence and where it's located and where it's obtained and what is with it is not of any concern to the public at this time, as this matter is sub judice, sub judice. Please appreciate that. And that's what I'm trying to lament, right? That is what we need to achieve in St. Lucia, that we give the judicial process time. I understand that everybody's concerned. Matters take so long. I just completed one matter that was 13 years old. I feel the pain of my country as well. And so we are trying, and with my appointment, we are trying our best to move these matters forward. I don't believe that any matter should take more than 6 months from the time of arrest to trial. And that is the goal that I wish after my stint and after my time that we achieve. But unfortunately, these matters, in terms of the impacts, as you've phrased it, went through one judicial process for the determination in the inquisition stage. And then, you know, we have still, this is not the complete criminal investigation. So we have to give these matters time, right? And I told you, I don't know whether you were there for the commencement, that I'm dealing with over 21 police-related shootings. And there are some, and you know, we focus on this, the stint between 2010 and 2011, but I have a few pending in the system since 2006, which I also have to give priority. People have lost their lives in that regard, and we must do justice to all of these matters. So just think about the massive stuff that we have to get done, over 21 of them.
I don't have an appreciation yet that you have answered the question. As far as the former Prime Minister and the pronouncements that he made and
that,
prejudice
I'm coming to this
the case.
One. I will not attempt to even give an opinion as to whether his actions were prejudicial to the case. I will not, as I will enter into this realm, which I am not going to, okay? And not even forced into, I won't. As I said, if he made pronouncements, they fell on deaf ears because I didn't hear them, as far as I'm concerned, all right? And I would appreciate that we allow the process to continue, so we can have some semblance of completion to these matters. Yes? You done?
Let me just ask on this one. I might come back. In terms
I might have to take some time on your show if necessary.
In terms of sub judice and the public's right to know, I think there has been some sort of difficulty in balancing the two.
Right.
Because from a media standpoint, you cannot presume what will go before the court.
Oh, I beg to differ.
You cannot presume.
I beg to differ.
You might have an idea. However, what goes before the court, we cannot determine that or prejudge what will go before the court.
Okay.
And it is the right of the media to discuss issues of public interest.
Yeah.
How do you balance the two, knowing that there is a separation between the work of the judiciary and the work of the media, as well
fine.
The work
Let
of
me tell you how
the
I
work of the legislature.
I understand your
and,
I understand
and
your
the work
question
of the executive.
Completely. And what I would say to you is this. What I would say to you is this. Most of the media personnel, they are well-educated persons, and we know that ignorance of the law is no excuse. I know for sure, as you are my colleague, and we went to school together, that you are quite aware of what happens, and I know that I am available, and I've said to some of the media practitioners, etc., that you can come and we can sit and discuss what is it, you know, the matters that can be aired, etc. Let me give you a simple example. As you said, we're not aware. There's a road accident. It's fatal. You know, someone dies. You go up to the driver, you know, of the vehicle, and you say to him, can you tell us exactly what happened? What more is there for me to say about this? If this person, who may become a party to the proceedings, and make some admission, and we must be cognizant of all of our laws. We have an Evidence Act. So if you want copies, you want me to present you with this, I think I assisted one person, you know, reference to some of these matters. I can, because I want to empower you so that these mistakes are not continued, right? And I disagree with you when you say you don't know. If you were empowered with the knowledge of what the law expects, you will know what is coming next. So you would be cautious in the way of delivering and indicating to the public what obtains. You simply have an indication of a matter, someone has perished, etc. But you don't go up to the person who may be, you know, a suspect in the matter and say, could you tell us exactly what happened? Now that is why I said that sometimes things seem very crazy to me. Okay, sir? I will take some time to answer a few more questions.
The 48 cases of obtaining 49 cases of obtaining property by deception, that matter is closed, correct?
Yes, I withdrew this matter. I withdrew the 49 matters against him, as we, and I'm saying, in terms of what the criminal procedure rules provides, etc. As we are innovative in our approach and as the law develops, we went into the mediation proceedings and a favorable outcome was found in
by
this.
By favorable, you mean Dr. Shams repaid the student?
The restitution.
Right.
And I can say clearly that $1 million was restituted to these students.
And so out of these students?
Or being, as a matter of fact, we, yes, continue.
There is still the charge for human trafficking.
Yes.
Four counts of human trafficking, correct?
Right.
Are the three students at Bodley, were they paid from that $1 million from Chance?
Now you see again, you may not have been listening to my introduction.
I asked you first, was the case
right,
closed?
The case, that part of the obtaining by deception,
so please answer the question.
Is done. The matter of obtaining property by deception is done. I cannot speak to that at all, right? Reference to the human trafficking matter. This matter is a distinct matter with distinct evidence to be sought, etc., and to be delivered to the court. And again, I would say to you, it is sub judice.
But I asked you
we
first.
Cannot.
The question I
yes.
asked first was about the obtaining property
right,
by deception.
Which I said it's closed.
Okay. The three prisoners on remand, for a separate matter. Were they part of the obtaining property by deception?
No.
And were they refunded?
Oh, no, they were not part of that.
Were they refunded?
No, they were not part of these proceedings. And as I say to you again, let me try to edify you and assist you in that regard. The contents of any mediation proceedings is confidential between the parties, Dale, and you should be aware of that. And that we should not divulge, right, what transpires in there. But we are saying that there was an outcome favorable to everyone in this matter. You have tried to now join the two matters, which are quite distinct. Okay? Quite distinct. Please.
My final question to you is, this is an anomaly to have the Director of Public Prosecutions entertain us mere mortals. Is this a one-time show for the Americans?
Never.
Or will this be continuous? Can we hold you to it?
I will, once I have the time, because number one, I don't listen to the talk shows. I have no time for that, right? I don't listen to a lot what plays off in the media. However, I will always be available to assist y'all. And that is what I want y'all to understand. This is not a one-off situation. Anyone who calls in, but I mean, we have to be respectful. There were a few who called in, right? And I found that it was quite, I will just reserve comment in that way, in that manner. But trust me, you'll have my word that every single media house, I can update you on things that I can speak of, you see? And that is the approach that we must adopt. I can't hide away from the issues. But if I can't speak to them, who can make me speak to them when I would be the one committing the prejudice? Right? So I hope that we are on par with this. No, not tell us nothing.
What have you already told us?
At the end of the day, no, but you want to know who is culpable, who is the... You can't do that. At the time when we have made a decision, you will come. The court is a public place. You know that. And you are able to attend, etc., and record in a very responsible manner. So I don't think that I've said nothing. I've said enough without crossing the boundaries to go into the nitty-gritty, to go into the integral parts of investigations, which I ought not to do.
Okay, I think we have a question from David.
Yes?
Yes, David Vitalis, Radio San Lucia.
Yes,
you guided us on your powers as DPP.
Yes.
Meaning that and one of these powers that you can go, it's not mandatory that we go to an inquest. You can institute criminal proceedings.
I can't institute criminal proceedings. Understand, the Director of Public Prosecution can continue or discontinue any criminal proceedings, right? But there's a memorandum of understanding between the Commissioner of Police, the police prosecutors, the police officers, and the Director of Public Prosecution. The proceedings are initiated by the investigative arm, which is the police. Then I can take over the prosecution of these matters right through. But I will make and submit opinions, reference to any investigation, right? And I'm saying, like I said before, there's no hard and fast rule that where there is a police shooting, where there is the loss of life, that there must be an inquest.
That was really to ask you,
right,
whether we are likely or whether there are grounds,
yes,
for this mandatory criminal, direct criminal prosecution in the impacts.
Are there grounds?
Yes.
Let me go into all of this. Like I said,
but are we likely to see you doing that?
Oh, you will likely to see a result, one way or the other. As I've said, over 21 of them, I've plotted the way forward, and there will be results. Okay. As to, they may not be the results that everybody's looking for, but they will be, from my professional standpoint, because I'm dealing with 21 in excess of that, some of them will be dealt with in another manner. Okay? Clearly. Now, I don't want to delve into the evidential issues and how much evidence is there and what needs to be done. So that's where you're sending me, and I can't go there.
Mr. Greene, just allow me to interject,
yes,
sir. Mr. Greene is running a very tight schedule. He has to rush back to court.
So
if we have one last question from you, David, and we have Stan.
Yes.
Yes. In terms of the... I kind of lost my train of thought. Matters the guidelines for matters sub judice.
Yes.
And the rights of the press.
Yes.
Are we restricted or barred under the law, in your interpretation?
Well,
making inquiries about cases delayed.
Oh no.
In a speculative manner.
You make inquiries about cases, however, speaking to issues relating to the witnesses or the evidence of the witnesses or how the court should determine these matters. This is what I'm trying to say. You can obviously report on what obtains. The matters are long outstanding. This person has been in prison for all of these years. What is happening? Push the judiciary, push the judicial process to go through and work. You see? But the minute you enter into the realm of speculating as to the strengths, weaknesses of evidence, etc., in the Crown's case or the defense case, I mean, I listened to the news on one occasion and I heard somebody indicating his entire case. Says exactly what happens. I mean, the media houses should know. Don't air that. That is that, and I believe, my friend, if you may agree with me in that regard, that you can't do that. That's going too far. To allow someone to say and to give an explanation or a defense or anything like that, right, on television is reprehensible. And that is why I want you and I want the media to say that you were not informed. Because I will not, and I'm hoping that the authorities, by way of the police, the commissioner of police by extension, I will not stand to tolerate this. And I want to be able to make everybody understand what is the limitations, so we don't go overboard. Did that answer your question? Much obliged.
Okay, we have one last question from the floor.
Good morning, everybody. Stan Bishop, The Voice newspaper. Obviously, the media and the public will be put in the spotlight for what seems to be them not doing the job the way they should. Mm-hmm. Now, we must understand that prime ministers, past and present, and DPPs, past and present, have alluded to the system being broken, and I'm speaking specifically to the justice system.
Right.
But that doesn't take away from the fact that people need to be responsible. Your workload is a heavy one.
Mm-hmm.
And you reference some cases that go back years that you're trying to catch up with.
Oh yeah.
Do you think you still have the full complement of staffing that you need? We've heard about 10 people in the office being the optimal. But given the depth to which we are right now, mm-hmm. 10 doesn't really sound plausible to me.
Right.
So do you think you have the right amount of staffing? And do you think you need more? And consider what you've been doing so far a fair amount of success? And finally,
oh yes.
Any progress in the human trafficking case involving the Russians?
I have no knowledge of that one. Okay. What is brought to my attention, I would deal with from the police. So let me go back to what you said initially. From the time I entered office in this regard, I noticed what was required. I did an examination of the shortcomings of my office, and I can say, you know, it gives me great pleasure to thank the government of St. Lucia for supporting me greatly in this matter by providing me with some of the, you know, the complements of equipment, etc., that I need. In addition to that, I also want to thank the United States of America. They have provided me for a full contingent of all of my IT needs in terms of all of the modern computers, printers, laptops, everything for my office. So I feel very confident with this contribution, and I'm quite grateful. I think that on about the 23rd of February, I'll be formally receiving these items, you know, that have been, you know, greatly, greatly, greatly sought. And I really want to thank the U.S. for assisting me in that regard. Further to that, we are going to have further Crown Counsel in the office, and I anticipate by the end of February, we'll have more staff, you know, a contingent of staff in the DPP's office. I've dealt with matters as old as 1982. You know, since I've come in, and I cannot understand why there would be matters pending where the defendant may have been over the age of 100 by the time the matter would have come before the High Court. But I believe in our system, and let me, just in conclusion, I know I have to go back, but I want persons to understand, because it's important. The High Court now is inundated with cases because we've changed our procedures. Before 2008, December, we were on the preliminary inquiry, where all preliminary inquiries for indictable matters were being handled in the Magistrates Court and then committed to the High Court. We have changed. So in principle, we have created a great, scheme to get to the High Court really quick. So we have what is called sufficiency hearings, and before 3 months of the occurrence of a matter is already before the High Court. However, this is where the bottleneck, result is created. Because now we've cleared up a lot of the work in the Magistrates Court, and now there's an immense need for dispensing with all of these matters before the High Court as they have gone through sufficiency hearings. Very great in principle. However, we need the support in terms of introducing more judges, having a proper venue for the courts. And I will side with you. The judiciary and the judicial system of any nation ought to be of paramount importance to the government of any nation. As any investor, anyone, will look to your judicial system and see what is going on. If it is in shambles, I don't think anybody would want to come. And I wouldn't say ours is in shambles. We work hard with what we have. But I anticipate that with the changes that are being made and the necessary, implements, that we will get satisfaction in terms of at least housing 4 judges for criminal trials exclusively, have another, maybe 2 masters before the High Court. That is what we need, plus my contingent of prosecutors, etc. So I see a very good road ahead. When I walked into my office, I noticed that there would have been, these computers were so old. I mean, I didn't understand how my staff, actually functioned in that regard. And I really appreciate them for that. Hard work in these sort of conditions, So we've been getting a lot of slack, but I believe there is significant progress ahead.
Okay, right? I think we have one last question. We'll make this one the last one, and then we'll
okay.
Carol Williams, the Star newspaper. Mr. Greene, congratulations again on your new post.
Thank you.
I have a follow-up question in relation to a question that Stan asked.
Yes.
The Russian case, the human trafficking case, it's an adult and semen venue that they were running, I think, in the north.
Russian.
And the deputy director of Bodley said it was an ongoing case.
Whoa. You'll have to get back to me on that. Can't answer to something I have no idea about. I haven't had any of these matters or this matter. What is the vintage of this matter that you speak of?
As far as I'm aware, it's an adult entertainment venue.
What vintage? How long ago?
Possibly a year or 2 years, I would say.
Okay, right.
Or 3
so
maybe.
It would cause for me to have to look into what is going on before I can make any comment on it. So I would definitely ask, what's the Russian? It's a Russian case.
Well, I know there are some Russians involved in the case.
Right. I'm not. Yes. That's all?
Yeah. Okay. Yes.
I think I have to go.
Greene is willing to engage.
Yeah, I have to go. But yes. Final question.
Final one. Okay. I mean, I'm going back to the need for information. Yes, I understand where you're coming from and the examples that you cite.
Right.
But is it a situation where judicial officers, for the most part, hide behind the sub judice in order not to comment on things that are in the public interest? There is a certain measure of information or level that
extent.
Can be divulged
yes.
to the public without compromising or prejudicing any case.
Mm-hmm.
That's one. The second thing is, the fact that you have gone through or gone forward with prosecuting the case as the DPP, isn't that an indication already that you have tried the case for yourself? If you did not, then you would not be prosecuting the case.
Oh my.
That
my
you have determined or you have reached a determination.
Let me answer your second question first. We are in an adversarial system of justice, right? Which means that everyone is entitled under the constitutional supremacy of this country to a fair trial, right? Whatever my opinion on anything is of no consequence as a prosecutor, right? I present the evidence for the tribunal of fact to determine. Let us understand what it is about. Whether it's a high court matter, there's a judge and a jury. The judge is the arbiter of law, so directs the jury on all the issues of law, and they must take the direction solely from him, right, or her. That is the arbiter of law, right, the judge of the law. However, a jury of your peers, that's what our constitution dictates, that you will be tried by a jury of your peers to determine your guilt or innocence. So I mean, at the end of the day, that is almost, I don't want to, that's bordering on, and I don't want to say that. But at the end of the day, the jury is the one to determine the guilt or innocence. My view should never be expressed, right? Should never be. And what it is, the Crown says you have sufficient evidence for the defendant to answer the case. So, you know, when the case is placed before the court, the judge has to determine whether there is sufficient evidence to go to the jury. If he says that the tenuous nature of this evidence, you know, it is so ridiculously tenuous, you know, that no reasonable jury properly directed could ever convict a defendant on it, he'll stop the case right there. But because of our system of justice, we must embark, basically. Right?
And you're a very learned jurist. And I'm sure that you'll not bring anything frivolous before the courts. Never would you do that.
I don't believe in that. And what I have done, and I need to assess matters. And I'm saying, as a judicial officer, you have to be fair. Okay? Remember, I was a defense attorney as well. 17 years. I recognize what both sides go through. I prosecuted many matters as well. You see? And when we all sit and think about things, who is the one who is at the worst or getting the worst end of the stick? The subject who is confined to prison, right? On remand pending trial. And this is one thing that I want in my stint to ensure that we can move forward in having a speedier process. I would love to see a homicide or a murder dealt with in 6 months. And that's my goal. I know some people will say, I'm holding Mr. Greene to it within 90 days of him saying so. The point is this, we have to set, you know, standards. We have to change the mindset. We have to move forward. We have to become compliant with our international partners and what they expect of us. We have to look at our laws and see what needs to be changed so we can fit well into this global environment. You agree?
Very much so. And right. I'm happy that you gave me that response. Going back to 360 parts GNH, as you quoted.
380,
parts on GNH, as you quoted earlier. Right. That would be the determination of the judge as well. If media have crossed the line.
Right.
Yes, we appreciate the guidance. However, I don't want media running scared, that they should not discuss things because they are sub judice. And, you know, because a lawyer, because a judicial officer has indicated that these things cannot be discussed.
You be careful. So what we do, you have to report on these matters. But I gave this simple example, and I think everybody can agree with me, the extent to which certain persons go to indicate. Could you tell me exactly what happened? Come on, Clinton. At the end of the day, anybody, you have common sense, would understand that you don't go there. You should not. Or if you don't, you shouldn't be a reporter. That's clearly what my opinion is. So what I intend to do, I don't want anybody running scared. And I told Mr. Elliott that I am opening my doors to y'all, right? So we can sit down and appreciate what is expected of us so that we have no problem. You agree to that? And I'm saying that if at any occasion I am needed to update on something that I can speak to, remember that I shall always be willing in the circumstances.
Okay. We've run out of time. Closing remarks from you.
Yes, I would like to thank everyone for taking the opportunity to come here, and I believe time is of the essence in every situation that we deal with. So I thank you for having me. I hope that I have indicated as much as I possibly can reference to these matters that are of great public concern. I continue to work assiduously on all of them so that they can be determined fairly, justly, and not in the court of public opinion. Right? I thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Mr. Greene.
Much obliged.
Thank you very much for coming. You've been a wonderful audience. And I think I could safely say that this is just one of other forums involving the office of the DPP and the media. Do you have a confirmation from you?
Indeed.
Okay, he has conceded.
You have my assurance in that regard. My assurance.
Okay, thank you very much. We've come to the end of the press conference.
Much obliged.